Gentlemen, I'm going to speak about F.W. the man. F.W. and I met in London in June 1989. I shall never forget the man who was about to embark on the Odyssean trip to change the status quo of his country. I shall never forget this man who mesmerized me, who made me want to help him to achieve this huge task ahead of him. Of course, I was naive. I had forgotten the most important thing. We were both married to other people. The journey of pain, suffering, and agony started. In 97, we decided to live our truth in front of God and people. We always trusted that God knows the end from the beginning. F.W. was a man of strong beliefs and great values and extremely correct. This correctness sometimes turned to his detriment. He was often misunderstood due to this over-correctness. We were once watching Walter Sisulu's funeral on TV. I remember him being very distraught and saying to me, "What have we done?" And I remember him, you know, being so upset. And I said to him, "Why can't you show this emotion to the public, to the people outside?" And he said, "I cannot betray my forefathers." But later, he was sorry for this. F.W. was a man of long planning. Once he knew what he wanted to achieve, he planned it meticulously, anticipating all obstacles in order to bring it to reality. He was torn between intellect and emotion. His emotion was for the pain the country was going through. He could not find peace in this horrendous system. This had affected him psychologically. He once told me of a repeated nightmare that he was having, falling out of an aeroplane free fall. At the time, I discussed it with my Jungian psychotherapist. The explanation was Mother Earth was calling him. The time had come to express his anima, his feminine side, his feeling side. He was a very private man, guarding his inner soul at all costs. The intellect was part of his upbringing, his conditioning to his Africanerdom, his loyalty to his country. Suddenly, he started seeing that choosing emotion did not seem betrayal. It meant justice. Of course, a lot of his fellow Afrikaners did not see it this way. Being Greek, I did not inherit the baggage of the past history of South Africa. F.W. and I had a lot of conversations about politics. With my interest in psychology, we often discussed how much the system of oppression had scarred the African soul. He was always concerned about the new South Africa, like a father to a young child. We had dinners with Madiba and Jakes Herwell, talking about this young child. How well is this young child? What are the challenges of this child with its troubled, compromised background? South Africa was blessed with extraordinary leadership. whatever the bitterness, the parents of the child knew that without peace, the child, the country, would be torn apart. There would be no development. Even though the disagreements FW may have had with the ANC, both he and the ANC understood this. The leadership of people like Madiba, Thabo Mbeki, and our current president, and FW's colleague, Rolf Meyer, and some others, ensured the country, however rocky its start, remained on track to become a democracy. I don't want to use the past tense when I speak about FW. My love for him will keep him by my side. I want to pay tribute to this man, the love of my life, who became perhaps, and listen to this, unlikely but a committed parent to a new country. Finally, I would like to say, according to Martin Luther King, that love is the only force, capable force, of transforming an enemy into a friend. In life, there are no strangers, only friends that we have not met yet. Thank you.